my privilege to welcome you today to a program entitled Pillars of Faith. Pillars of Faith. This is a series of programs that we air to give a good foundation for life from Scripture. And each one of our Pillars of Faith programs look at various subjects of Scripture that are foundational for life. And today, I am privileged to introduce to you our speaker, our own C.A. Murray, Pastor C.A. Murray. He is a student of Scripture. He has the love of God in his heart. He's much loved here at 3ABN, and I know you viewers around the world love Pastor Murray as well. His series is entitled Walk This Way. Oftentimes, life has been described as a journey. We walk along this journey in life. It's important that we follow a good map so that we reach the destination that we want to achieve, you know, at the end of the road. And of course, we hope that destination is heaven. And there's no better map that I know of than the Word of God. And Pastor Murray has developed a wonderful series entitled Walking This Way. Part one was Stay This Way. Part two, The Wise Way. Part three, Pray This Way. And now we are going to hear as Elder Murray presents Be This Way. So I will have a word of prayer, and then I would ask all of you to give our own Pastor C.A. Murray your undivided attention. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, we just thank you so much that you loved us enough to not only give your Son and send us the Holy Spirit as we need for a guide, but you also left a written word that we can hold and read and use as a map for guiding life. Please be with your manservant, Elder Murray, as he breaks the bread of life to us. Give him clarity of thought. Give him articulation of tongue. And may we listen and take heed to the word, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much. I can call him actually Pastor Brian Hamilton, though he is now the CFO here at 3ABN. Brian has pastored and is no mean student of the word. He's a solid content preacher. He stood in this pulpit many times on Sabbath morning and delivered the word with passion and with power. And if we are fortunate and blessed, we'll get to hear him in a future Pillars of Faith. He is a good preacher and one who divides the word well. Today's message is a little something that I put in simply because I wanted to add something to this series that pertained to our daily walk, to making our Christian walk better. So we're taking, dare I say, just a slight left turn, but it does fall into the regime that we have established. Stay This Way was Paul's counsel to the Hebrews, who were Hebrew Christians, I need to say, who were thinking about returning back to Judaism. And Paul, in his, dare I say, apologetic, in his commercial, in his reciting and reminding the Hebrew Christians of the pedigree of Christ, the greatness of Christ, the all-encompassing uniqueness of Christ, was encouraging them throughout the book of Hebrews, now that you've begun to walk this way, stay this way. Don't go back into Judaism. Don't go back into the old way, even though it's convenient, even though it certainly has less trauma and drama than the new Christian faith. Stay this way. Stay with your brothers and sisters. And then we talked about the book of John in dealing with the wise way. And John, in the Gospel of St. John, does almost the same thing that Paul is doing to the Hebrew Christians. He is giving a, dare I say, a commercial for Jesus. He is telling them of the excellency of Christ. Again, the uniqueness of Christ. And we saw in the wise way the touchless Jesus. We saw a Christ whose miracles did not contain any kind of physical touch. And we said that the reason for the way John structured his gospel, the way he viewed Jesus, is because John wrote to an audience who lived after the death of Christ, who was the second generation of Christians towards the end of the first century, didn't know Christ face to face, didn't touch Christ, didn't handle Christ. All they had was the testimony of the apostolic fathers and the word. And we established that when you've got the word, it's as good as having the presence. So those who were with Christ had no advantage over those who came a little bit later because of the power of the word. In the beginning was the word was with God, and the word came and dwelt among us. And so their connection to Christ was the word. And John is saying that that connection is as strong as the physical connection, and healing can come about through the word, just like it can come about through the touch. And then we dealt with another aspect of the gospel on yesterday's presentation. So we see now that in the staying this way and wisdom's way those things that Christ has asked us to do, we can serve him faithfully. So today we want to look at an aspect of Christian living, of Christian growth, of Christian life that I think is important to our Christian living and will help us as we walk this road that leads to glory. I'm going to ask you to turn with me now to the Old Testament. 2 Samuel chapter 9, verses 3 through 8. 2 Samuel 9, 3 through 8. And we will speak with the Lord just once more. Father God, we ask you to bless our words as we look at a very special aspect of Christian living. Would you please give us a complete understanding so that we can know and do that which is right? We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. When we spoke of pray this way yesterday, our last presentation, we looked at the model prayer, and there are aspects of that model prayer that really feed into what we are going to talk about today as we looked at Matthew chapter 6 on yesterday. But I'm in 2 Samuel chapter 9, beginning at verse 3. Then the king said, "Is there not still someone of the house of Saul to whom I may show the kindness of God?" And Ziba said to the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan who is lame in his feet." So the king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "Indeed, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Ammiel, in Lo Debar." Then King David sent and brought him out of the house of Machir, the son of Ammiel, from Lo Debar. Now when Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, had come to David, he fell on his face and he prostrated himself, the Bible says. Then David said to Mephibosheth, and he answered, "Here is your servant." So David said to him, "Do not fear, for I will surely show you kindness for Jonathan, your father's sake, and will restore to you all the land of Saul, your grandfather, and you shall eat bread at my table continually." Then he bowed himself and said, "What is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? Be this way." His name means exterminator of shame, or in short, idol killer. You don't hear many sermons about Mephibosheth, and that is possibly because, one, the name is rather difficult to pronounce, and two, as I learned from the learned editors of the Wycliffe Bible Encyclopedia, who all agree, he is possibly the poster child for a life of disaster, a life of disappointment. He was born into a disgraced family, dispossessed, orphaned, crippled as a child. Most of his early life and his formative years were spent in hiding, in a sort of forced seclusion, always afraid that he would be caught and summarily executed. He was placed in sort of a witness protection program. All of this through no fault of his own. Mephibosheth had done nothing wrong. His only sin was being born into the wrong family at the wrong time. Now, of course, you've heard that you can choose your friends, but you don't get to select your family or your relatives, and even sometimes your in-laws. When you find someone that you want to love and you say, "I do," that "I do" includes the in-laws, the outlaws, and everybody else connected with that person you love, and you don't get to choose them. They come as part of the package. So you don't get to choose your family, but you do get to choose your friends. And Mephibosheth's only sin was being born wrong family, wrong time. And then when life and the Lord give him a break and turn his fortunes, he gets lied on and loses it all. Anybody ever been lied on? Someone just tells a lie that kind of just destroys your life. I mean, one of those character assassination kind of lies. One of those kind of lies that it's hard to recover from and that people tend to want to believe. Not just damage or ruin your reputation, but the kind of lie that can destroy your livelihood or even your life. That's kind of tough. Mephibosheth was victimized by such a lie. And the truth is, he never fully recovered. It's almost as though he was predestined to be the fall guy for the sins and machinations and God-cursed conduct of so many around him. No wonder he doesn't get preached on too much. No wonder we don't preach about him too much, because on the face of things, there's not much good to preach about, except one thing. One beautiful, God-blessed thing that we're going to come to a little later, which actually is the basis for this entire sermon. So let's quickly examine his pedigree. Let's take a look and contextualize this man with the strange name that means idol killer or smasher of idols. Let's look at his legacy and the legacy that was left to him. First of all, he came from and was born into a wealthy family. Now, most people would say, so what's wrong with that? He's born into wealth. His grandfather was Israel's first king. His grandfather was quite rich. And those riches passed, I'm sorry, his great-grandfather was quite rich. Those riches passed to his grandfather, to his father, and should have passed to him. His grandfather, great-grandfather, was Israel's first king. King, appointed, anointed against God's will. I need to make that point. 1 Samuel chapter 8, with the election of Saul, Israel changed from a theocracy, a nation ruled by God through priests and judges and prophets, to an aristocracy, or even an oligarchy, a nation ruled by kings, priests, and prelates. The election of Saul, you need to understand, was ostensibly a beauty contest. With Saul, it was all outside. It was all surface. It was all patina. It was all facade. It was all veneer. It was all polyurethane coating. Inside, the Bible lets us know, as do the sacred writings, Saul had no heart. In the book Patriarchs and Prophets, we read this about King Saul. The personal qualities of the future monarch were such as to gratify that pride of heart which prompted the desire for a king. So they wanted him to be king, and he wanted to be king. His own pride drove him to want to be king. Reading further, there was not among the children of Israel a more goodlier, not godlier, a more goodlier person than Saul. Saul was a good-looking guy. But the truth is, Saul had no business being king. Saul had no business ascending to the throne. The truth is, and the Bible brings this out, there was nobody better looking than Saul in the entire nation. Saul was the best looking guy there. Let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 9, and I'll read you verses 1 and 2. I'm in 1 Samuel, just go back one book, chapter 9. And we'll look at verses 1 and 2. This is kind of interesting. 1 Samuel 9, 1 and 2. The Bible says, there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel, the son of Zeror, the son of Bechorah, the son of Aphiah, a Benjaminite, a mighty man of power. And he had, now listen to the words that the Bible employs here. And he had a choice and handsome son, whose name was Saul. There was not a more handsome person than he among the children of Israel. So you get that. The Bible is making it plain that Saul was the best looking guy in the entire nation. Nobody looked better than Saul. And you know, when you're the best looking guy in the room, that puts a little pressure on you. When you walk into the room and everybody's head turns and the women say, man, he is good looking. And even the guys say, man, he is good looking. He's the best looking guy in the kingdom. Tall and devastatingly handsome. You know, in our culture, it's interesting because people defer to good looking people. In Western culture, we equate beauty with honesty. Yeah, we do. I had the chance years ago when I was pastoring. A man came to me. He was, I think, as I recall, 69 or 70. Very wealthy. And he wanted me to marry a girl who was turning 40. I think she was 38, 39, just sub 40. He's just over 70. And I would not do it. Because in talking with her and in counseling with them, it occurred to me that this may have been a situation where she was going after the cash and not the man. And so I told him, I don't think this is a good match, and I'm not really comfortable doing this wedding. I think she's taking you for a ride. And I told him that by himself. And he said to me, Pastor, look at her. You see, we equate honesty, and beauty. Beautiful people never tell a lie. Beautiful people are never evil or do wrong things. And Saul is the best looking guy in the entire kingdom. He's the most handsome guy in the entire kingdom. And look what else the Bible says. I'm in verse 2. Bible says, from his shoulders upward, he was taller than any of the people. So not only is he the best looking guy in all of Israel, he's the tallest guy in all of Israel. Nobody comes up taller than his shoulders. So he's gorgeous to look at. He's taller than everybody else. And he is a person who, when the people saw him, they said, this guy has got to be the king because nobody looks as good as he does. Nobody as tall as he is. He's got to be the leader. Tall and devastatingly handsome. But look at this, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 608. Of noble and dignified bearing, in the prime of life, comely and tall, he appeared like one born to command. So when they saw Saul and they thought of who a king should be, the women said, anybody that looks that good has got to be the king. Look at him. Taller than everybody else. He's better looking than anybody else. We want him to rule over us. But let's finish what it says here. It says, yet with these external attractions, Saul was destitute. Now, what does destitute mean? Totally devoid of. Saul was destitute of those higher qualities that constitute true wisdom. In other words, Saul's only qualifications to be the king of Israel was that he was tall and good looking. But he didn't have any of the qualities that make for a good king. He was just, as we like to say today, eye candy. Looked good, but inside he had no heart. And that's not enough. Let's look at the last line in this little reading from the book Patriarchs and Prophets. Saul had not learned in his youth to control his rash, impetuous passions. He had never felt the renewing power of divine grace. So, this is the guy we're going to make king. He's better looking than everybody else. He's taller than everybody else. But he lacks self-discipline. He doesn't have self-control. And he's never had a relationship with God. And this is the guy you're going to make the king? He has the power as king to control you, yet he doesn't have the power to control himself. He can run your life, but he cannot run his own. And worse than that, the guy's got no God in him. So we're going to make him the king simply because he's taller than everybody else and he's better looking than everybody else. But those qualities which make for a good ruler, compassion, self-control, empathy, caring, and a love for God, he doesn't have any of that. And this is the guy we're going to make king. Wealthy, self-indulgent, from the tribe of Benjamin, a big fish in a small pond. That is why when Saul was finally dispatched and they were looking for a second king, the Bible makes it plain, man looks on the outward appearance, God looks on the heart. You can't go with it because it's tall and handsome and looks good. You got to see what's inside. You got to see what's in the heart. Let me just take a quick left turn and say this too. When you look at the life of Saul and the life of David, if you look at the list of sins, the truth is David's list of sins far exceeds and is much longer than Saul's. And I've wrestled with that for many years. How come Saul got rejected so easily? I shouldn't say so easily, but after what seems like a short list of sins, and David, who murdered and caballed and slept with someone's wife and fathered a child and went on and on and on and on and on and on, and God seemed to labor with him so long. And I think maybe we get a little clue here. David knew God. When David was out in the field with Goliath, slaying bears and slaying lions, David knew God. We find here, Saul never knew God, never had a relationship with God. There was nothing in the bank for Saul. And so when Saul went off the tracks, he went off far. He didn't take blame for his own sins. At least David, when he sinned, said, "Lord, if you got to spank me, count to 10 before you do it. But I have sinned and I've sinned against you." Saul never took blame for his sins. And so the prophet Samuel leaves Saul, and you know the story. He never speaks to Saul again. And then after Samuel dies, Saul decides he needs to talk with him. And what does he do? He breaks another command of God and goes to a witch. And the witch comes up in the form of Saul. And even the witch tells him, "You and your family are going to die." Then Samuel dies. Saul is left alone, and one day it all comes true. Now, I need to say here that Saul has a son by the name of Jonathan. Jonathan loves David, and David loves Jonathan. They are two individuals who are knit together, just two guys who liked each other, who loved each other, the Bible says. Israel is fighting Philistia at Gibeah. The Philistines kill Jonathan, his brother Abinadab, his other brother Malchishua. Saul is hit by an arrow, and in chapter 31, verse 6, he asked for his armor bearer to kill him. Armor bearer is not going to kill the king, even at the king's request. And so Saul commits suicide and dies in disgrace. His army is destroyed. Israel is humiliated, and Jonathan's son's nurse panics on that day. And this is what is interesting. Jonathan's son's nurse hears what happens at Gilboa. She panics, and in 2 Samuel 4, chapter 4, when she hears of the death of Jonathan and Saul, she grabs the little boy and runs in terror and drops him, and he becomes a cripple from that time on. So little Mephibosheth never really has a chance in life. On the day that his dad is killed, his two uncles are killed, his grandfather is killed, his nurse makes him a cripple when she drops him and fractures both of his ankles. There is some indication that he still could walk, but he walked very ungainly and was crippled for the rest of his life. Now, war breaks out between Saul's family and David's family. And this is the way it is in ancient days. Once a new king comes in, then everybody then in the old family gets exterminated, or war breaks out. And Abner, Saul's general, kills Asahel. Joab and Abishai, David's general, kill Abner. And there is this systematic extermination of the family. And as David's house gets stronger, Saul's house is getting exterminated and getting weaker. And Mephibosheth is taken into hiding, a self-imposed exile for a full generation. In fact, he is so far off the radar, so far off the charts, that when David finally finished all of his wars, he remembers a promise that he made to Jonathan, who he loves. He said to Jonathan, "When I become king, I will do something for your house. I'm not going to take out on you the bad things your father, Saul, did to me. But I will do something for your house because of our relationship together." And here's where the story picks up in 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1. 2 Samuel 9, verse 1. This is where the story picks up in the scripture lesson that we read. And the thread is not long. David had promised Jonathan that even though there was enmity, he was going to do something for his house and for his lineage. Took a full generation, 20 years plus, to fulfill that oath. But there had been so much time and so much killing and so much hatred between the two houses, the house of David and the house of Saul, nobody even knew if anyone was left from Saul's family. So when David asks, he is informed by Ziba that there is a lifelong crippled son of Jonathan by the name of Mephibosheth. And we see in the book Patriarchs and Prophets, written by Ellen White, that Mephibosheth had been trained and taught through those long years of hiding to blame, distrust, and hate David. So when he is brought before David, you see why the Bible says he came in trembling, because he's assuming that David has discovered him and is going to finish exterminating the house of Saul because he was the last one left. But no, David told him not to fear. I'm not going to take your life. I'm going to give you back all of the land that your grandfather had. And I'm going to restore you, and I'm going to let you eat at my table every day. Now, that term can be taken a couple of ways. One, I will set a place for you at my table. The other is, I will provide to make sure you have food at your table from my table every single day. In other words, it meant a full acceptance and restoration of Mephibosheth. When you ate at someone's table, when you were invited to eat at someone's table in Bible times, that was full acceptance of who you are and what you are and what you're all about. And so David was saying, I'm saying you're now part of my family because of my love for your father. Then we see the expression of Mephibosheth, who in shock says, what are you doing that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? We could write a whole sermon, preach a whole sermon on the term dead dog. There aren't many stronger terms of disrespect and disregard in the Old Testament than dead dog. It's a totally self-deprecating term. When you use that term, you're really saying, I'm nothing. I'm less than nothing. You recall when David fought Goliath, and Goliath was so upset that he, this giant champion, would be asked to fight this little stripling boy. He said, am I a dog? You're going to send this little kid out here to fight me? When Abner slept with Rizpah, Saul's concubine, Ish-bosheth accosted him on that. And he said, am I your dog that you would talk to me like that? So though the term doesn't have that kind of strong connotation in our day, back in Bible days, when you use dog or am I a dog or this person is a dog, you're really using strong language. Am I a dog is a term of total disrespect and total disdain. So when Mephibosheth says that you would have compassion on a dog, a dead dog such as I, he is humbling himself in the strongest way before David and saying, I'm just like nothing. I'm nothing. And I'm humbled and shocked that you would do this thing for me. And from that time on, his life changed. The key that I want to wrestle with in the last little bit that is here before us was the gratitude. When we talk about be this way, the way I want you to be is gracious and have gratitude for God. Gratitude is a life-changing quality. And I believe that this little story is put here for two reasons. One, it shows the love of two men and how one kept his promise to the other. But it's also there because of the gratitude of Mephibosheth. It's mentioned because even in the face of systematic ingratitude and injustice, the story in the story within the story, is the gratitude of Mephibosheth. Here is Ellen White's closing line on Mephibosheth. He became strongly attached to David, and like his father, Jonathan, he felt that his interests were one with the king whom God had chosen. In other words, his heart went out to the man who he thought all of those years was going to kill him, and it was his gratitude that bound up his life with David. Now, that's important in these last days because the opposite of gratitude, I think, is entitlement. The idea that you deserve something, and you hear about that so much today. But gratitude ought to mark and earmark the life of a Christian. The necessity of gratitude is part of the Christian life. To be grateful for the things that God has given us. Gratitude makes our life happier, makes our life sweeter, makes our walk with the Lord so much better. So I want to touch on gratitude, or perhaps ingratitude may be better. Isn't it interesting that most of the counsel on gratitude or ingratitude is found in four books of what we call the Spirit of Prophecy? Testimonies for the Church, Testimonies to Ministers, Messages to Young People, Ministry of Healing. There is an intimate and intricate connection between gratitude to God and mental health, we are told. That when we express gratitude for the blessings that we have and show appreciation of the attentions that we receive from God, it keeps the heart full of the precious promises of God. Now, that's in the book Five Testimonies. In other words, when you show gratitude for what God has done for you, with you, to you, through you, it makes you a better person to be around. It makes your heart lighter. It makes your mind sharper. It makes you happier, and it brings you closer to God. In the book Thoughts from the Mount of Blessing, another great book, page 84, Ellen White talks about Christ's Sermon on the Mount. She writes this: God watches for some return of gratitude from us as a mother watches for the smile of recognition from her beloved child. You know, when babies are born, the things we go through to try to make them smile. You know, we do all the kind of things we do to make the child smile. And when you get a little smile, oh, your world is just perfect. And then you want to do it again. You want to have the baby smile again. And you see, grown people act like children trying to get children to smile. Well, that's what Ellen White is alluding to here. She is saying that God is watching us to look for a return of gratitude on the blessings that he's given us. Now, you may be selfish and prideful to say, God hadn't done anything for me. The fact that you can speak means he's done something for you. The fact that you are bold enough to make such a foolish statement means he's blessing you. So God is saying, I'm looking for a return. I'm not asking for your money. I'm not asking you to swim the deepest river. I'm not asking you to climb the highest mountain. I'm not asking you to cross the deepest sea or widest ocean. I'm just saying, be thankful for what God has given you. I'm just saying, show a little gratitude for the blessings that you have. And if you do not say thank you for what you got, why would God give you anything more? Just be thankful. He, that is God, would have us understand how earnestly and tenderly his heart yearns over us. He invites us to take our trials to his sympathy. our sorrows to his love, our weakness to his strength, our emptiness to his fullness. Never has one been disappointed who came unto him in sincerity. Now that's something to be grateful for. When you don't have anything, he's got everything. When you don't have any friends, he'll be your best friend. When all you've got is sorrow, he'll give you joy. When all you've got is weakness, he'll give you strength. When you're empty, he can make you full. For those things, we ought to be grateful. The result of fellowship with gratitude to God will increase our piety, our purity, and our fervor. So in other words, fellowship with God through gratitude will make you more pious. What is pious? Piety is sincerity and fervor in which you do the things of God. That's piety. That's the sincerity that you approach the things that God has asked you to do. Purity, that means the things that you do are motivated by unadulterated motives. You're not supposed to use the answer in the question. So the things that you do are, I don't want to say motivated, but they are, the force that drives what you do for God comes from unadulterated motives. In other words, you're not going to serve God because you're trying to get something from him. You're not going to pay your tithe because you want him to bless you. You're going to pay your tithe because he loves you and you love him, and that's what he's asked of you. It just so happens when you pay your tithe, God says, I'll pour you out a blessing. But your motives are pure. You do something not to get something. You do something because that's what love does. So your piety is increased, your purity is increased, and your fervor is increased. Now, fervor is the energy that you put into anything God asks you to do. You can be a reluctant Christian, you can be a reluctant servant, or you can be an energetic servant. And when you show gratitude to God, your piety increases, your purity increases, your fervor increases. So your Christian walk will get better if you be this way. If you are a gracious person, as Mephibosheth was. How often, I'm in 5T, first, fifth volume of the Testimonies, page 315. How often those who are in health forget the wonderful mercies that are continued to them day by day, year after year. They render no tribute of praise to God for all his benefits. But when sickness comes, God is remembered. Is that not so? The strong desire for recovery leads to earnest prayer. And this is right. So we're told that when you pray earnestly to get well, there's nothing wrong with that. For he is our refuge in sickness and in health. But many do not leave their cases with him. They encourage weakness and disease by worrying and complaining. You need to thank God. It is tough. It's tough when you're sick to think about when you're well, when you were well, because you just want to get rid of that sickness. But we are being told here that if we are as gracious to God, if we show as much gratitude in sickness as we do in health, God will actually work through to make us well again. And even while we are sick, having gratitude helps us deal successfully with the sickness. Now, you can shake your fist at God and say, this is all your fault. Or you can look back on the times when you were well and say, God, I thank you for those good days, and I pray that you will restore them. And being gracious, having gratitude, will help your mental faculties even while your body is suffering. And that's what we're trying to get through here, that gratitude helps you wrestle successfully with the issues of life. And don't always be looking on everybody else's plate. Be gracious and thankful for what you have. I always see people, you know, looking on other people's plate. Let them worry about their plate. You don't know what comes with that plate. You don't really know what comes with that plate. Just be gracious and thankful to God for what God has given you, and that will open the door for God to give you more. She says, if they would cease repining and rise above depression and gloom, their recovery would be much more and would be sure. They should remember with gratitude how long they enjoyed the blessing of health, and should this precious boon be restored, they should not forget that they are under renewed obligation to their Creator to show Him gratitude. When the 10 lepers were healed, only one returned to find Jesus and to thank Him and to give Him glory. Let us not be like the unthinking, ungrateful 9 whose hearts were untouched by the mercy of God. You don't want to be like that. When God does something good for you, show a little gratitude. And it's not always just cash. People tend to say, well, the Lord bless me, I won the lottery. Well, the Lord bless me, I got some money. The Lord bless me, I found, you know, there are blessings in being able to sleep at night when you go to bed. There are blessings in having a good friend to talk to when you got troubles. There are blessings being part of a church that tells the truth and knows the truth. There are blessings that come that you cannot quantify, and yet they make the quality of our Christian life so much better. Colossians chapter 3:15. Let me just slip that in. When you open your eyes in the morning, thank God that He has kept you through the night. Thank Him. Show Him a little gratitude. Thank Him for the peace in your heart. Morning, noon, and night, let gratitude as a sweet perfume ascend to heaven. Why is our gratitude so limited? Ellen White asks. It is only a ripple on the surface compared with the great tide of love given to us by God that flows to us from the Father. The spirit of gratitude promotes health. So if you want to be healthier, particularly mental health, be thankful for what you've got. All true religion, fourth volume of the Testimonies, page 223, all true religion is filled with gratitude. In the fifth volume of the Testimonies, page 474, Christ is abused by ingratitude and by the ingratitude of His people. Satan reproaches Christ, Christ's Object Lesson, page 168, because of our ingratitude. Satan says, listen, you're blessing them, you're saving them, you're taking care of them, you're doing all this stuff, and nobody even says thank you. You ought to just quit and then see what happens to them. Satan would like that. But God loves us too much. Messages to young people. Ellen White says, we are stupid. Now you're saying, Ellen White wouldn't say a word like that. She wouldn't call us stupid. A messenger of the Lord would never use the word stupid. Well, oh yes, she would. She would use that word. In fact, she did. I'm in Messages to Young People, page 365. He, that is God, has implanted in the hearts of His children, it's you and me, the love of the beautiful. Beautiful sunsets, beautiful flowers, beautiful people, beautiful situations, beautiful mountains. But by many, this love has been perverted. The benefits and beauties which God has bestowed upon us have been worshipped, while the glorious giver has been forgotten. So rather than thanking God and being grateful to God for giving us these things, we turn our attention and worship the things and not the person who made those things or who gave us things. Now comes the quote. Messages to Young People, page 365. This, she says, that's giving praise to the thing and not the giver, this is stupid ingratitude. Messages to Young People, 365, this is stupid ingratitude. And if you are unthankful or ungrateful for for what you have, why would God undertake to give you anything more? If you cannot thank him for what you have, be it little or great, why would you deserve more if you're not thankful for what you got? Hebrews chapter 13, 5. Conduct yourself without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Isn't that something to be grateful for? It's repeating an Old Testament proverb found in Joshua 1:9. I will never leave you nor forsake you. The fact, the very fact that you've got a God who has promised to stand by your side, to stick with you through thick or thin, is something to praise God for and to be thankful for and to be grateful for. I'm in the fifth volume of the Testimonies, page 645. In gratitude, we read, oppresses the soul and separates us from God. That's a dangerous position to be in. Be separated from God. Simply because you're not grateful? Simply because you won't show gratitude for what you have? And as I said before, don't compare yourself with others. We all need pride. Pride is the kind of thing that makes you brush your teeth and comb your hair in the morning before you go to work or come to church. That's pride. Pride makes you look at yourself in the mirror to make sure your clothes are on straight. That's pride. And nothing wrong with that kind of pride. The problem is when pride becomes proud. And how does pride become proud? When you compare what you are, what you have, with somebody else. That's when you become proud. That's when pride, which is good, becomes proud, which ain't. Because the only person you're supposed to compare yourself with is Jesus. Because when I compare myself with anybody else on planet Earth, I'm going to find a way to come out looking better, smelling better, thinking better, singing better, talking better. Somehow, I'm going to say, well, he's better looking than me, but I got more money. Or he got more education than me, but I have more common sense than him. You know, when you compare yourself with other people, you're always going to come out some way, you're going to find some way to justify who you are. Until you compare yourself with Jesus. No way you're going to come out of that equation looking good and smelling good. What you come out is a realization of precisely who you are. And you realize you got nothing to be proud about, and your only pride is in the fact that Jesus loves you and died to save you. So ingratitude oppresses the soul, separates us from God. 2 T 6:40, cherishing ingratitude puts your salvation in peril. Now that's when you ought to underline. Cherishing ingratitude puts your salvation in peril because it makes you disrespect the God who saves you. Cherishing ingratitude puts your salvation at risk. So we can be lost. We can be lost for being ungrateful. Let me close with this story. I, years ago, had a chance to go to Uganda and cross into Kenya on a mission for 3ABN. We had a new radio station that was being produced, one in Uganda and one at the conference office in Kisi, Kenya. I found out that on the African continent, they have a nut. Call it a berry, but it's really a nut because it's quite hard, called the taste berry. When you chew this nut, you don't swallow it, you just put it in your mouth and you chew it, you crunch it, and just chew it. Chew it for about 5 minutes. For the next hour or so, everything you eat tastes sweet. Now, the nut itself does not taste sweet. It's the effect that it has on your taste buds. So they call it the taste berry. Because, I mean, you can eat bitter roots, herbs, take foul-tasting medicine. Anything you eat after chewing this nut tastes sweet. And the effect lasts for quite a little time. So young children who have, well, they don't let children take it too young because it does have some little side effects. You don't want kids tasting that thing because it has a little caffeine in it. But evidently, everything that adults take, medicines, anything else, after chewing this thing, tastes sweet. It occurs to me that gratitude is the Christian's taste berry. If you are in right relationship with Jesus, if your heart is open to the things of God, if you see the things of God in the right perspective and are grateful for what God is doing for you, with you, to you, through you, you will find that even life's most bitter experiences can taste sweet, that something good can come out of it, that those things which would break a lesser person make you stronger because of the gratitude you have for the God who sees you through. There's no promise in heaven or on earth that everything is going to be hunky-dory and pain-free. In fact, the Bible says, in the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome. That's John 16:33. You're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer. Be gracious. Have gratitude, because even with the tribulation, you've got a promise that Jesus has overcome the world. And you can overcome, even as he has overcome. That, brothers and sisters, is our taste.